सर मैं बाबा की जय। सो फी स्टॉप दैट, रिक्वेस्टिंग ऑल ऑफ यू टू गो ऑन म्यूट बिकॉज आई थिंक वन माइक इज नॉइजी फॉर वॉट एवर रीजन।
Hey, you want to do the seven realities?
Thank you very much. So that is बाबा की जय। एग्जिस्टेंस, लव, सैक्रिफाइस, रिनंसिएशन, नॉलेज, कंट्रोल एंड सरेंडर। आई गिव नो इम्पोर्टेंस टू क्रीड, डॉगमा, कास्ट और द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ रिलीजियस सर्मनीज एंड राइट्स, बट टू द अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ द फॉलोइंग सेवन रियालिटीज। द ओनली रियल एग्जिस्टेंस इज दैट ऑफ द वन एंड ओनली गॉड हु इज द सेल्फ इन एवरी इनफाइनाइट सेल्फ। द ओनली रियल लव is the love for this infinity God, which arouses an intense longing to see, know, and become one with its truth, God. The only real sacrifice is that in which, in pursuance of this love, all things, body, mind, position, welfare, and even life itself are sacrificed. The only real renunciation is that which abandons, even in the midst of worldly duties, all selfish thoughts and desires. The only real knowledge is the knowledge that God is the inner dweller in good people and in so-called bad, in saint and in so-called sinner. This knowledge requires you to help all equally as circumstances demand, without expectation of reward. When compelled to take part in a dispute, to act without the slightest trace of enmity or hatred, to try to make others happy with brotherly or sisterly feeling for each one, and to harm no one in thought, word, or deed, not even those who harm you. The only real control is the discipline of the senses to abstain from indulgence in low desires, which alone ensures absolute purity of character. The only real surrender is that in which poise is undisturbed by any adverse circumstance, and the individual, amidst every kind of hardship, is resigned with perfect calm to the will of God. Tar Mehr Baba Ki Jai. With that, I'll go back to where we left. So we stopped at the end of this paragraph. One second, there's some knock on the door. So I think, when the aspirant, before that, the subtitle, each stage on path, a curtailment of ego life. When the aspirant enters a new plane, he's merged into it. And along with the slowing down of mental activity, he experiences a substantial diminution in the ego life. This curtailment of the ego life is different from the final annihilation of the ego, which takes place at the seventh plane. One more second.
Karthik, you continue. I think anybody can accept. So you should continue.
Are you sure of that?
Because it popped up, I clicked and the window went off. Yeah, so I think so. Yeah.
Oh, then why don't you try the next time?
Yeah.
I'll leave it with you.
You should continue.
Thank you. Yeah. But like the final annihilation at the seventh plane, the different stages of the curtailment of the ego are at the intermediate six planes, deserve special mention owing to their relative importance. I'm reading this line again. I didn't read it right. But like the final annihilation at the seventh plane, the different stages of the curtailment of the ego at the intermediate six planes deserve special mention owing to their relative importance. In the Sufi spiritual tradition, the final annihilation of the ego is described as fana phila, and the earlier samadhi of the six planes of duality have also been recognized as kinds of fana. since they also involve a partial annihilation of the ego. First three funas. Through all these funas of ascending order, there's a continuity of progression toward the final fana phila, and each has some special characteristic. When the pilgrim arrives at the first plane, he experiences his first fana, or minor annihilation of the ego. The pilgrim is temporarily lost to his limited individuality and experiences bliss. Many pilgrims, thus merged, think they have realized God and hence get stuck in the first plane. If the pilgrim keeps himself free from self-delusion or comes to realize that his attainment is really a transitional phase in his journey, he advances further on the spiritual path and arrives at the second plane. The merging into the second plane is called Fana e Batili, or the annihilation of the false. The pilgrim is now absorbed in bliss and infinite light. Some think that they have attained the goal and get stranded in the second plane, but others who keep themselves free from self-delusion march onward and enter the third plane. The merging into the third plane is called Fana e Zahiri, or the annihilation of the apparent. Here, the pilgrim loses all consciousness of his body and his world for days and experiences infinite power. Since he has no consciousness of the world, he has no occasion for the expression of this power. This is Videha Samadhi, or the state of divine coma. Consciousness is now completely withdrawn from the entire world. If the pilgrim advances still further, he arrives at the fourth plane. The merging into the fourth plane is called Fana e Malakuti, or the annihilation leading toward freedom. This is the dangers of the fourth plane, which Baba has referred multiple times in God Speaks, and now he does it again. The pilgrim experiences a peculiar state of consciousness at the fourth plane, since he now not only feels infinite power, but also plenty of occasion for the expression of that power. Further, he only has occasion for the use of his powers, but has a definite inclination to express them. If he falls prey to this temptation, he goes on expressing these powers and gets caught up in the alluring possibilities of the fourth plane. For this reason, the fourth plane is one of the most difficult and dangerous to cross. The pilgrim is never spiritually safe, and his reversion is always possible until he has successfully crossed the fourth plane and arrived at the fifth. Fanas of the fifth and the sixth plane. The merging into the fifth plane is called Fana e Jabruti, or the annihilation of all desires. Here, the incessant activity of the lower intellect comes to a standstill. The pilgrim does not think in the ordinary way, and yet he is indirectly a source of many inspiring thoughts. Sanjay, just let somebody. Did that work?
Yeah, the window went off. Alok, somebody was trying to join. Yeah.
Ashok, is it?
Ashok.
Yeah. Ashok. Yeah. Perfect. So okay. It worked.
It's working.
So I'll.
I got a bit late. I was trying to get in.
No problem. He sees, but not with the physical. The pilgrim does not think in the ordinary way, and yet he is indirectly a source of many inspiring thoughts. He sees, but not with the physical eyes. Mind speaks with mind, and there is neither worry nor doubt. He is now spiritually safe and beyond the possibility of a downfall. And yet, many a pilgrim on this exalted plane find it difficult to resist the delusion that he has attained godhood. In his self-delusion, he thinks and says, "I am God," and believes himself to have arrived at the end of the spiritual path. But if he moves on, he perceives his mistake and advances to the sixth plane. The merging into the sixth plane is called the Fana e Mahabubi, or the annihilation of the self, the lover in the beloved. Now the pilgrim sees God as directly and as clearly as an ordinary person sees the different things of this world. This continual perception and enjoyment of God does not suffer a break even for an instant. Yet the wayfarer does not become one with God, the infinite. Finally, fana phila or nirvikalpa, the state of conscious Godhood. If the pilgrim ascends to the seventh plane, he experiences the last merging, which is called fana phila, or the final annihilation of the self in God. Through this merging, the pilgrim loses his separate existence and becomes permanently united with God. He is now one with God and experiences himself as being none other than God. This seventh plane fana phila is the terminus of the spiritual path, the goal of all search and endeavor. It is the nirvikalpa state, which is characteristic of conscious Godhood. It is the only real awakening. The pilgrim has now reached the opposite shore of the vast ocean of imagination, and he realizes that this last truth is the only truth and that all the other stages on the path are entirely illusory. He has arrived at the final destination. So that's the end of the chapter. I think that was 24, I think, or 22. Arriving at self-knowledge. So yeah, actually, I will stop.
I just want to make one comment here. The last plane, it says, if the pilgrim ascends to the seventh plane, mm-hmm. he experiences the last merging, which is called fana phila, mm-hmm. The final annihilation of the self in God. You know, you have to remember that Discourses was written by God Speaks. When we read God Speaks, when you enter the seventh plane, first happens fana, which is actually nirvana. And nirvana is defined as consciousness is, God is not. It's a divine vacuum. And after nirvana happens fana phila, which is called the second stage of fana. So the first stage of fana is nirvana, and the second stage of fana is fana phila, which is nirvikalpa samadhi, where you have I am God state, which is actually the Satchitananda stage, infinite knowledge, infinite power, and infinite bliss. Whereas nirvana is only bliss. So that is just a add-on.
Yeah. I have a question.
Go ahead, Dasho.
We say that there's an illusion, but even in the sixth plane, you may be under the illusion. So how do you, conclude that you have reached the seventh plane? That's something, which is, what is the, the concluding proof that you have reached the, this is something which is very enigmatic.
I think it's like the baby, when it's born, it doesn't know its gender, male or female. Uh-huh. As it becomes mature, then you know the differentiation. So I think when you go from the sixth plane to the seventh plane, this is just an analogy I'm saying that. So, in the sixth plane, you're actually seeing God everywhere, in everything, like the Parvardigar prayer. Mm-hmm. But the difference is that you still have this duality of I and you. And Baba said, you and I are not we, but one. I am God conscious. You are in the process. And whereas in the seventh plane, there is no more duality. You merge with the ocean, with the Oversoul. The soul merges with the Oversoul. The Atma unites with the Paramatma and realizes that there is no difference between Atma and Paramatma. Right now, the drop soul, even though it sees God, it doesn't feel that, it still has this separativeness. Jai Baba,
this is interesting. Thank you.
Very good point. And I'm just reminded of that Ward Park's video, which I went back to in my free time. Again, that was an introduction to God Speaks. And God Speaks is something I think we will keep reading and reading and reading and uncovering new parts. So I suggest when you have time, take the 2 hours and listen to it. I have not been through the whole thing again. I listened only for 50 minutes. But Ashok's question is addressed there as well. Baba has said, and Baba says that this experience is only personal, and you'll never know till you get it. So, and if you remember, even in God Speaks, he says that this is something that cannot be described, right? So words cannot describe this, and hence we will always be having the question that Ashok has, and we'll have to just make that leap of faith and continue in the process. The logical mind will keep popping this question, we'll keep it aside.
Absolutely. It's like experiential learning, actually experience it.
Correct. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
In fact,
one cannot explain these things, but still, there is a difference between when you are in bliss and when you have knowledge also. You are in bliss and you have the knowledge of the entire universe. Suddenly it appears in front of you. So I'm sure there will be a very distinct and different, environment or whatever it is. Will be very different and very different, distinct in each and every phase.
Sure.
But one need to experience it.
Yeah. In fact,
one more innocent or ignorant question.
Yesterday we had a paragraph to the same effect, actually. You remember? There was a paragraph on the same effect that you just keep on doing and then slowly you evolve.
So correct.
Yeah.
I'm not able to recollect, but
yeah. Just there. Yesterday.
Yes, yes. Great. Mm-hmm. So, Sunil, you had a question.
Yeah. Can we move between planes in one lifetime, or one has to leave the body to move from one plane to another? Or also, can we cross two planes at the same time in one lifetime?
Whoa, okay. Second question is interesting. Okay. But, with divine grace, maybe you can do that. I don't know. All I think is from the verbiage. Yeah.
With divine grace, you can get nirvana.
Directly,
instantly.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So from the verbiage, it looks like you can move through these planes in one lifetime. I'll defer to Karma. Or anybody else who wants to jump.
There's a phrase, enlightenment is like winning the lottery ticket. Okay. And the thing is to keep doing our sadhana, as Baba said, intense effort and infinite patience. And he will take us veiled. We don't have to know about these planes, Like, for example, I have mentioned earlier that Ramana Maharishi gave probably nirvana, to a cow, Lakshmi the cow, and also his own mother, A very interesting story, I will try to find that and send it to you guys. So you don't have to bother anything. The way I look at it, we have to just dissolve our ego. The love is already latent in us. Even in God Speaks, Baba says that whole thing is already latent in us. And as you go on reading the discourses, you will see that it's just the dissolution of the ego that is important, because love is already latent. Baba is already inside us. So that is the only task we have, So we don't have to worry about all the different planes. It's unnecessary.
Thank you.
I just wanted to add, removing the dust.
It is not unnecessary, but yes, Baba will take us with proper veil, so we don't need to worry about this.
Can I come in? Tushar here.
Yeah, go ahead, Tushar.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba, everyone. I've been here since 7:25. Sunil has asked this question earlier also. I've answered this question earlier.
Sorry.
And maybe he's not understood, so I'm trying to make him understand in a different way. See, self-realization is not nirvana. You can be self-realized, yet be taking new births. Understand that as long as your sanskaras are still there, even if you have progress in terms of consciousness, you will have to be born again and again until your sanskaras are over. This is the reason I asked Kama yesterday.
Very well said.
The bodies,
very well said.
Out of the bodies. Okay?
Yes.
And
yes.
Baba has talked of up to the mental body only. There are bodies ahead of that also. So I hope you have understood this, Sunil. As long as you have sanskara, you have sanskara is the thing. Sanskaras is the thing.
Unwind.
I think Ashok's question, I wanted to come in. Take baby steps. Don't think of sixth and seventh plane. Just talk of your hindrances right now, near you. Okay. And take the first step, then take the second step. Don't jump to the sixth step directly. This is what I feel. It's academic and only imagination.
Tushar, I have an objection with what you said. I think what I know, I was discussing with Karthik.
Yeah.
That what we are trying to do is we are using God Speaks, Baba's literature as our platform, as a foundation. And if there are other sources which are able to complement that, fair enough. I think you're bringing something from outside.
I think in that case, don't bring in Maharshi Raman, don't bring in Shri M, anyone else. Okay? I'm trying to make you understand by increasing the vista. My aim is not being dogmatic, sticking to God Speaks. Okay. There are truths not written in God Speaks. Okay? Baba has not mentioned many truths. Because we are not at a level to understand all that.
We are not interested.
No, I think
so my objection is also with you. Don't bring in your all what you know. Okay? All your degrees, keep it at your home.
This is just a discussion. Self-realization, your definition is wrong.
I may be vociferous. I am discussing.
Your definition of self-realization
is wrong. It does not merely apply to
God. Realization is nirvikalpa samadhi. Please understand. Please read God Speaks. And
I have God Speaks. Plus. And I have understood it very well. Please don't tell me how I should understand.
I think your terminology, the definitions you are using are incorrect. I think we are using the terminology.
Self-realization is a terminology used by Baba. Correct? Baby steps, you said. I just extended it.
Is right. Self-realization nirvana or nirvikalpa samadhi?
Let's not get into argument. Please just continue. No. I have left the group earlier also. I can leave right away again, if you wish.
That's your choice. Okay, we are
only don't go there, Kama. What he was saying was making really sense. So let it be. Just leave it. Yeah,
I am increasing the vista to make people understand, right?
Perfect. So what you were saying was right, and Kama, you need to, listen to others also politely and just leave this chapter. Don't go into it.
I wanted to interject on Tushar's point on only one thing, which is the self-realization, right? The self-realization term is, as Kama said, is, are you talking about nirvana or are you talking about nirvikalpa samadhi? Because from a common vocabulary, especially for such a large group, we have almost 10-12 people now, the common vocabulary is very key. So we shouldn't take away wrong precepts, wrong understandings when we finish our sessions, right? So I appreciate the breadth and vistas that you want to expose us to, Tushar. But I would only say that we'll start with God Speaks, the definitions of Baba and the maybe limited ways of what he has said in God Speaks and Discourses, and then open up our vistas. This is a journey.
I think right? in my second coming, mm-hmm. I have stuck to what Baba has said.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. And I want everyone else, not to mention of Goengaji, not to mention of any other thing. Maharshi Raman does not figure in Baba.
Can I say something? Sorry.
Yes, Sunil, go ahead.
Rules apply to everyone.
I'm on the plane zero, so sorry for asking that question. So let's move on.
No, it's not Baba his right. Question. I don't
Sarin think it's also good. Right. We have to unwind sanskaras in the beginning. So let's just do that. We have babies right now. At least I am, so sorry about that.
Jai Baba.
Soft copy, page 135, arriving at self-knowledge. I'm continuing
Jai Baba.
Yeah. Is there an interruption or just a Jai Baba? Jai Baba.
No, just a Jai Baba. Okay, thank you. Saying Jai Baba to her.
Yes, yes. Okay, so when the time is right, we will continue. Before that, I will read the subtitle. Progress towards self-knowledge, gradual and imperceptible. When the time is right, the advancement of a person towards self-knowledge comes about as naturally as the physical body of a child grows into a full-fledged form. The growth of the physical body is worked out by the operation of natural laws, and the progress of the aspirant towards self-knowledge is worked out by the operation of spiritual laws pertaining to the transformation and emancipation of consciousness. The physical body of a child grows very gradually and almost imperceptibly. And the same is true of the spiritual progress of a person once he has entered the path. The child does not know how its physical body grows. In the same way, the aspirant also is often oblivious of the law by which he makes headway toward the destination of his spiritual progress. The aspirant is generally conscious of the manner in which he has been responding to the diverse situations in life, but rarely conscious of the manner in which he makes progress towards self-knowledge. Without consciously knowing it, the aspirant is gradually arriving at self-knowledge by traversing the inner path through his joys and sorrows, his happiness and suffering, his successes and failures, his efforts and rest, and through his moments of clear perception and harmonized will, as well as the moments of confusion and conflict. These are the manifestations of the diverse samskaras that he has bought from the past, and the aspirant forges his way forward, his way towards self-knowledge through the tangles of these samskaras, like the traveler threading his way through a wild and thick forest. Scope of consciousness and its working. Human consciousness might be compared to a flashlight that reveals the existence and the nature of things. The province illuminated by this flashlight is defined by the medium through which it works. Just as a person confined to a boat can wander anywhere on the surface of the water, but can have no access to remote places on land or in the air, the actual working of the flashlight of consciousness is determined by the accumulated samskaras, just as the course of the rivulets flowing down a mountain is determined by the channels created by the natural contours of the mountain. Average person only conscious of the gross one. In the case of an average person, the sphere of life and stage of action are restricted to the gross world, because in him, the flashlight of consciousness falls on the physical body and works through it. Being restricted to the medium of the gross body, he can be conscious of anything within the gross world, but is unable to establish contact with subtle or mental realities. The gross sphere thus constitutes the arena of the average individual and all his activities, and thoughts have a tendency to be directed towards the gross objects that are accessible to him. During this time, he remains unconscious of the subtle and the mental spheres of existence, since the flashlight of his consciousness cannot be focused through the medium of the subtle or the mental body. Identification with the physical body. At this stage, the soul is conscious of the gross world, but is completely ignorant of its own true nature. It identifies itself with the gross body on which the flashlight of consciousness falls. And this naturally becomes the base for all the activities within its range. The soul does not directly know itself through itself, but by means of the physical body. And since all the knowledge it can gather through the physical body points to the physical body itself as the center of its activities, it knows itself as being the physical body, which in fact is only its instrument. The soul therefore imagines itself to be a man or woman, young or old, and takes upon itself the changes and limitations of the body. I think the key thing is this line, And since all the knowledge it can gather through the physical body points to the physical body itself as the center of activities, it knows itself as being the physical body, which in fact is only its instrument. After several rounds of lives in the setting given by the gross world, the impressions connected with the gross world become weak through the long duration of the experience of opposites, like great happiness and intense suffering. So this is about identification with the subtle body. The weakening of the impressions is the beginning of the spiritual awakening, which consists in the gradual withdrawal of the flashlight of consciousness from the allurements of the gross world. When this happens, the gross impressions become subtle, facilitating and inducing the soul's transference of the base of conscious functioning from the gross body to the subtle body. Now, the flashlight of consciousness falls on the subtle body and works through it as its medium, no longer working through the gross body. Therefore, the whole gross world drops from the consciousness of the soul and it becomes conscious only of the subtle world. The subtle sphere of existence now constitutes the context of its life, and the soul now considers itself to be the subtle body, which becomes and is seen to be the center of all its activities. Even when the soul has thus become subtle conscious, it remains ignorant of its own true nature, since it cannot itself directly through itself, but it cannot know itself directly through itself, but only by means of the subtle body. I'll read the line again if it was confusing the way I said it. Even when the soul has thus become subtle conscious, it remains ignorant of its own true nature, since it cannot know itself directly through itself, but only by means of the subtle body. Yeah. However, the change of the stage of action from the gross to the subtle sphere of existence is of considerable significance. In the subtle sphere, the conventional standards of the gross world are replaced by new standards that are nearer the truth, and a new mode of life is rendered possible by the dawning of new powers and a release of spiritual energy. Life in the subtle world is only a passing phase in the spiritual journey and is far from being the goal. But out of millions of gross conscious souls, only a rare one is capable of becoming subtle conscious. Identification with the mental body. Impressions connected with the subtle world get worn out in turn through, for instance, some forms of penance or yoga. This facilitates and brings about a further withdrawal of consciousness inwardly, whereby the flashlight of consciousness comes to be focused on the mental body and begins to function through it. The severance of conscious connection with the subtle and gross bodies means that the gross and subtle spheres of existence become completely excluded from the scope of consciousness. The soul is now conscious of the mental world, which affords deeper possibilities for spiritual understanding and a clearer perception of the ultimate truth. In this new setting of the mental sphere, the soul enjoys continuous inspiration, deep insight, and unfailing intuition, and it is in direct contact with spiritual reality. Although it is in direct contact with God, the soul does not see itself as God, since it cannot itself directly through itself, but only through the medium of the individual mind. It knows itself by means of the individual mind and considers itself to be the individual mind, for it sees the individual mind as being the base and center of all its activities. Although the soul is now much closer to God than in the gross or the subtle spheres, it is still enclosed in the world of shadow, and it continues to feel separate from God owing to the veil created by the impressions connected with the mental sphere. The flashlight of consciousness is functioning through the limitation of the individual mind and does not therefore yield the knowledge of the soul as it is in itself. through the soul, though the soul has not yet realized itself as being God, its life in the mental sphere of existence constitutes a tremendous advance beyond the stage of the subtle sphere. Out of millions of subtle conscious souls, only a rare one can establish conscious contact with the mental sphere of existence. Need for a master. It is possible for an aspirant to rise to the mental sphere of existence through his own unaided efforts, but dropping the mental body amounts to the surrenderance of individual existence. This last and all-important step cannot be taken except through the help of a perfect master, who is himself God realized. Out of millions of souls who are conscious of the mental sphere, only a rare one can withdraw the flashlight of consciousness from the individual mind. Such withdrawal implies the complete vanishing of the last traces of the impressions connected with the mental life of the soul. When the flashlight of consciousness is no longer centered upon any of the three bodies, it serves the purpose of reflecting the true nature of the soul. Direct self-knowledge. The soul now has direct knowledge of itself without being dependent upon any medium, seeing itself not as some finite body, but as infinite God and knowing itself to be the only reality. In this major crisis in the life of the soul, there is a complete severance of the connections with all three bodies. Since consciousness of the different spheres of existence is directly dependent upon the corresponding bodies, the soul is now entirely oblivious of the whole universe. The flashlight of consciousness is no longer focused upon anything foreign or external, but is turned upon the soul itself. The soul is now truly self-conscious and has arrived at self-knowledge. The false self-knowledge, a temporary substitute. The process of arriving at self-knowledge through the three spheres of existence is attended by the acquisition of false self-knowledge, consisting in identification with the gross or the subtle or the mental body according to the stage of the process. This is due to the initial purpose of creation. I request someone who's not yet gone on mute. This is due to the initial purpose of creation, which is to make the soul self-conscious. The soul cannot have true self-knowledge except at the end of the spiritual journey. And all the intermediate forms of false self-knowledge, as it were, temporary substitutes for the true self-knowledge. They are mistakes necessary in the attempt to arrive at true self-knowledge. Since the flashlight of consciousness is turned throughout the journey toward the objects of the environment, and not upon the soul itself, the soul has a tendency to become so engrossed in these objects that it almost completely oblivious, that it is almost completely oblivious of its own existence and nature. This danger of utter and unrelieved self-forgetfulness is counterbalanced by the self-affirmation of the soul by means of the three bodies, which happen to be used as the focal points of the flashlight of consciousness. Thus, the soul knows itself as its own bodies and knows other souls as their bodies, thereby sustaining a world of duality where there is sex, competition, aggression, jealousy, mutual fear, and self-centered exclusive ambition. Hence, self-knowledge of the soul by means of any external sign is a source of untold confusion, complication, and entanglement. Pumpkin story. This form of ignorance may be illustrated by means of the famous pumpkin story referred to by the Persian poet Jami in one of his couplets. Once upon a time, there was an absent-minded man who had no equal in forgetting things, even his own identity. He had an intelligent and trusted friend who wanted to help him to remember himself. This friend, attached a pumpkin to his neck and said, "Now listen, old man, one day you might completely lose yourself and not know who you are. Therefore, as a sign, I tie this pumpkin around your neck so that every morning when you wake up, you will see the pumpkin and know it is you who are there." Every day, the absent-minded man saw the pumpkin upon waking in the morning and said to himself, "I am not lost." After some time, when he had become used to self-identification through the pumpkin, the friend asked the stranger to remain with the absent-minded man, take the pumpkin from his neck during his sleep and tie it around his own neck. The stranger did this. And when the absent-minded man woke up in the morning, he did not see the pumpkin around his neck. So he said to himself, "I am lost." Then he saw the pumpkin on the other man's neck and said to him, "You are me. But then, who am I?"
Beautiful. This,
very beautiful. And this is a very, very relevant
and analogy. Pune, Baba used to live in a pumpkin house.
Yes.
Must be, there will be many stories related with pumpkins.
So he continues on the analogy made explicit. This pumpkin story offers an analogy to the different forms of false self-knowledge growing from identification with one of the bodies. To know oneself as the body is like knowing oneself by means of the pumpkin. The disturbance caused by the ceasing to identify with the gross, subtle, or mental body is comparable to the confusion of the absent-minded man when he could no longer see the pumpkin around his own neck. The beginnings of a dissolution of the sense of duality are equivalent to the man's identification of himself as the stranger who wore his pumpkin. Further, if the absent-minded man in the story were to learn to know himself through himself, independently of any external sign, his self-knowledge would be comparable to the true self-knowledge of the soul, which, after ceasing to identify with the three bodies, knows itself to be none other than infinite God. Arriving at self-knowledge is the very goal of creation. Any discussions on the pumpkin before we continue?
I would like to share something.
Go ahead.
जो हमने सारे chapters पढ़े हैं और सुनील जो question पूछ रहे थे, तो एक chart है, बहुत small chart, कि gross body में क्या क्या functions होते हैं, subtle में क्या होते हैं, mental में क्या होते हैं. So during the hours from morning to evening, जो हम lifestyle lead करते हैं, अगर if we see that minutely, we will realize that how many hours we give or how many hours we give in, you know, in for gross body, for all those things, and for subtle and mental, and slowly and gradually you can shift everything. So whatever energy you have for the day, you can, you know, slowly and gradually shift those things. And this is the beginning with, this is a process. This is a process which helps me a lot. You know, if you are watching a show, which is world's best show of cooking, but it's again a gross on the consciousness. So one need to realize and identify those things and remove that from your system, first of all. All needs to be removed. And that's how, you know, one can proceed and be in some good, better state than whatever you are in right now, or whatever you want to proceed or go ahead with. So that is my process, that I minutely see that where I am today and what I'm doing today. I should not be very focused on my, you know, television or food habits or whatever. So one needs to cut down all those things if you need to go ahead and progress further.
So is there a chart preference that you have, which you can
yeah, I can make a chart and I can forward it to you, but each one is own, you know, what is your own chart. You make your own chart and it helps a lot.
Okay, Great.
I think my understanding of pumpkin was partially or almost there to my question, not to associate yourself with the physical body, but with the consciousness of the soul.
Yes.
So I think it addressed my question also. Thank you.
Great.
Jai Baba, can I read out just four lines?
Sure.
Yeah. It says the mind should be kept in check until it is dissolved into the heart. This is both knowledge and liberation. The rest is multiplication of books.
Beautiful.
Multiplication of?
Books. No, I mean, it's just what you kind of read and, you know, what you imbibe.
Yes.
Yes.
It's not, it's not from the heart.
Great. Great. Very nice. Thank you. So I continue with the next chapter, God realization.
Sorry, who is awakened? There is one name.
Awakened, yeah. Yes.
Who is that?
Can you get out of mute and tell us who you are?
Huh?
There's one participant whose name, whose profile says awakens.
Awakened. I think Neha.
No, she's not. That's contact Neha. So somebody is awakened, and I asked when we started. So I think it's a good practice. Let us know. So I'm okay with welcoming, as everybody keeps sending me posts. But then we'll just like to know.
No, if you are inviting someone and someone listening,
you should let us
know.
Yes, please.
Tell him to come out and just introduce himself or herself, whoever. That person.
Yeah. Awaken, are you there? No response. Okay. So I think as a we'll have to add that to the house rules.
No. Yes, ask him. Ask.
We'll knock off people who don't introduce or use a name that we recognize. Thank you. I'll continue. God realization. To arrive at true self knowledge is to arrive at God realization. The title is To Realize the Self is to Realize God. I'll just take a pause here. I think there is more to these subtitles, or at least I want to believe that till I'm proven otherwise. So I'm actually working on putting all these subtitles together for each topic and see if there is any correlation or at least a kind of notes, right? So you make one summary, go to the next summary, go to the next summarization, and so on. So I'm making that, I'm doing that experiment. I've taken my son's help. So I'll analyze that for a couple of chapters and then come back to the group with what I find.
So there is a lot of meaning there.
Exactly. So, and I think he's confirming understanding, then going to the next one, then going to the next one. So it's basically known to the unknown in each chapter. So it might be a powerful way of understanding, and we have to use that correctly. So I'll read again. To realize the self is to realize God. To arrive at true self-knowledge is to arrive at God realization. God realization is a unique state of consciousness. It is different from all other states of consciousness because all other states of consciousness are experienced through the medium of the individual mind. Whereas the state of God consciousness is in no way dependent upon the individual mind or any other medium. A medium is necessary for knowing something other than one's own self. For knowing one's own self, no medium is necessary.
In fact,
that
sentence is the crux of it.
Correct.
Then repeat it.
For knowing one's own, in fact, these two sentences, right? They summarize the whole thing. A medium is necessary for knowing something other than one's own self. For knowing one's own self, no medium is necessary. In fact, the association of consciousness with the mind is definitely a hindrance rather than a help for the attainment of realization. The individual mind is the seat of the ego or the consciousness of being isolated. It creates the limited individuality, which at once feeds on and is fed by the illusions of duality, time, and change. So, in order to know the self as it is, consciousness has to be completely freed from the limitation of the individual mind. In other words, the individual mind has to disappear, but consciousness has to be retained. I'm just going to close the window. These birds are making a racket. Throughout the past, the title is Consciousness and Mind Intertwined. Throughout the past life history of the soul, its consciousness has grown with the individual mind, and all the workings of consciousness have proceeded against the background of the individual mind. Consciousness has therefore come to be firmly embedded in the individual mind and cannot be extricated from this setting which it has been woven. The result is that if the mind is stilled, consciousness also disappears. The intertwining of the individual mind and consciousness is amply illustrated by the tendency to become unconscious when there is any effort to stop mental activity through meditation. This is an interesting line. The intertwining of the individual mind and consciousness is amply illustrated by the tendency to become unconscious when there is any effort to stop mental activity through meditation. Explanation of sleep. The everyday phenomenon of going to sleep is not essentially different from the lull experienced during meditation, but it is slightly different in its origin. Since the individual mind is continuously confronted by the world of duality, it is involved in ceaseless conflict. And when it is wearied by unrelieved struggle, it wants to lose its identity as a separate entity and go back to the infinite. It then recedes from the world of its own creation and experiences a lull. And this lull is also invariably accompanied by the cessation of consciousness. The quiescence of mental activity, resuming wakefulness after sleep is the title. The quiescence of mental activity in sleep entails the complete submerging of consciousness. But the cessation of mental life and conscious functioning is only temporary, because the impressions stored in the mind goad it to the renewed activity. After a while, the stimuli of the impressions result in stirring the mind and reviving the conscious functioning that is performed through its medium. So the period of sleep is followed by a period of wakefulness, and the period of wakefulness is followed by a period of sleep, according to the law of alternating activity and rest. As long as the latent impressions in the mind are not completely undone, however, there is no final annihilation of the individual mind or emancipation of consciousness. In sleep, the mind temporarily forgets its identity, but it does not finally lose its individual existence. When the person awakens, he finds himself subject to his old limitations. There is a resurrection of consciousness, but it is still mind-ridden. The limited obstacle of ego. The limited mind is the soil in which the ego is securely rooted. And this ego perpetuates ignorance through the many illusions in which it is caught. The ego prevents manifestation of infinite knowledge, which is already latent in the soul. It is the most formidable obstacle to the attainment of God. A Persian poem says truly, "It is extremely difficult to pierce through the veil of ignorance, for there is a rock on the fire." Just as a flame cannot rise very high if a rock is placed upon it, a desire to know one's own nature cannot lead to the truth as long as the burden of the ego is placed on the consciousness. Success in finding oneself is rendered impossible by the continuation of the ego, which persists through the journey of the soul. In old age, an aching tooth can give untold trouble because it is not easily uprooted, although loose within its socket. In the same way, The ego, which might become feeble through love or penance, is yet difficult to eradicate. It persists till the very end. Though it becomes looser as the soul advances on the path, it remains till the last stage, which is the seventh plane of involution of consciousness. Difficulty of...
Just repeat that.
So, it's basically that the ego, it becomes lesser and lesser. The last line?
Yes.
Though but it becomes
it
looser...
It still remains.
Yes, till the seventh plane.
Oh.
Though it... See, in the sixth plane, we just talked about that, right? He said that he sees himself as separate. There is the concept of duality even in the sixth plane, right? Though he sees God in everybody around him, in that plane also the soul is able to identify himself as separate.
Okay.
Right? So, it becomes looser as the soul advances on the path. It remains till the last stage, which is the seventh plane of consciousness, seventh plane of involution of consciousness. Kama.
Karthik, I think this sentence, there's a semantic problem out here. I think it should be the sixth plane of involution of consciousness. Because in the seventh plane, the ego is zero. Sanskaras are zero. So, the last stage, I think it has to do with the way the sentence is structured, you know. I was struggling with it because it should be till the sixth plane of involution of consciousness where the mind is there. But in the seventh plane, there is no
mind.
It's
not there. Correct. Agree. So though it becomes, and the other thing I was thinking was, looser is not the word, right? So I think it's, though it becomes lesser as the soul advances on the path, it remains till the last stage. Which should be sixth. I agree with you. Which is the sixth plane of involution of consciousness. But Baba, we don't know. We just read it as it is.
Yeah.
But good observation by both of you. Difficulty of overcoming ego. How are we doing on time? Okay. So I'll just finish with this paragraph. Difficulty of overcoming ego. The ego is the center of all human activity. The attempts of the ego to secure its own...
Just write the note here in the group or somewhere. So, you know, you could always ask or mail someone and ask.
Yeah, I'll remember to edit that.
Thank you.
The ego is the center of all human activity. The attempts of the ego to secure its own extinction might be compared to the attempt of a person to stand on his own shoulders. Just as the eye cannot see itself, the ego is unable to end its own existence. All that it does to bring about self-annihilation only goes to add to its own existence. It flourishes on the very efforts directed against itself. Thus, it is unable to vanish altogether, though its own desperate, through its own desperate activity, although it succeeds in transforming its own nature. The disappearance of the ego is conditioned by the melting away of the limited mind, which is its seat. So, I will stop here. And open up also for any discussions and questions. And by the way, just a reminder to the members of the group, tomorrow is the show and tell, share and tell Baba session. I also thought we will not record it. It's just for people to get to know each other on this group. So after the 1 hour of discussion, we will spend some time and discuss just at a personal level. So that will be maybe for another hour, if everybody is okay. So can we have a quick word on that? Is everybody okay with that?
Sure. Yes. Absolutely.
Can I suggest a little different time? Because 2 hours in the morning will get a little too much. So
okay.
you know, with little shorter break in the evening or some other time. Is that okay? Or
yeah,
that's okay.
Better, in fact.
Yeah, that would be better.
Okay, so what is the alternate time? We have to just keep the sensitivity.
Anytime.
Yeah, it's a Sunday tomorrow. So
before RT, let's meet before RT. Then we all can join in RT.
That's
let's
a
meet
very good idea.
Around 6:15 or 6:15.
6 o'clock. Let's... No, let's do 6 o'clock. We need
okay.
a lot of time. There's 10
okay.
people. In fact, we should
okay.
join at 5:30, if possible.
Uh-huh.
5:30, and then 7 o'clock we end with RT. See, what happens
perfect.
Is everybody has, I'm sure, experiences on the Baba world which we'd
oh,
like
yeah.
to share. And we know very little about each other, and it's boring to read bios. Nobody reads them. So we thought we'll spend time to know
yeah.
each other in this journey. So please feel free to join at 5:30. We'll
yeah,
get started at 5:30. Whoever can come at 5:30, it'll be great.
Yeah. I mean, Kartik, I may not be able to join. Maybe some other time I'll introduce myself. So
sure.
today is I'm joining the Hyderabad online server.
Ah,
okay.
Even I want to join that.
Yeah,
that is
and
really nice.
I'm going to attend that.
So
that's
I,
lovely.
Gopi has asked me to sing a song so online
oh,
for
nice.
The first time.
Oh,
oh nice. nice.
So even I'm going to attend that. I'm not going to miss that.
Great.
That
no, but that gets over at about 7. Yeah, that's true. After the hour.
Yeah, yeah. In that during that period itself, 5:30
yeah,
to sometime.
Time.
Yeah, yeah.
Correct. So
tomorrow it can happen in some other at some other time, you know.
Okay, or we can do it the next week. That doesn't really matter. It's not
yeah.
not time sensitive,
yeah,
so we can
yeah.
probably do it next weekend, right?
Yes.
Next weekend, maybe Saturday or Sunday. We'll decide on Thursday.
I guess Saturdays would be better because Sundays, I think there are a lot of online sessions happening. So.
Correct.
Maybe not.
Yeah, this will happen again. So this.
Some next Sunday, maybe some other center or Ahmednagar center or whatever.
Correct. Agreed.
Unless we start at 7:15, is that we okay with everyone?
Yeah,
I'm
okay with
that. Or...
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Yeah, yeah. 7:15 is also okay.
That's fine. That's
yeah.
fine.
Seven,
that's
let's
fine.
Start at 7:15.
Yeah.
But it's a bit late for Singapore. Namita,
okay.
Yeah.
okay.
Yeah. Are you okay?
I mean, it's okay.
Yeah, whatever is convenient to everybody, we'll fit in.
Okay, so we'll try to not keep you up too late with our boring introduction.
No, it should be very interesting.
She'll come in.
By
first.
The way, I am also participating in one of the Bangalore Sehvas. They wanted me to talk about my experience with Baba. I'm actually talking for an hour, so. I'm busy preparing in the midst of everything that I'm doing here. What's that?
When is Bangalore?
That Bangalore thing is at 10 to 12
okay.
with a prayer at the end.
Today?
Yeah.
Today?
Today, yes.
Could you please send
I'm
me the
not
link?
Sure. I will check and share because they had some restrictions on Skype which limited it to 50 people.
Oh.
I'm not sure if they have gone over that. So
okay.
if it's open, that's fine. And anyway, I'm thinking of recording it. So I'll probably share.
Yeah, you can put it up on the side. Yeah, you can share
yeah,
it.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
Anyway, we'll talk more directly tomorrow. So I'm looking forward to.
So now the final
is 7:15 tomorrow evening.
Oh.
So we'll just have the 1 hour as planned, as always in the morning, and have a 7:15 discussion, and keep the thirst from going to bed early.
Look forward to knowing you better. Because you have all to speak up for our
Yes. Yes. Sure. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
Thank you.
Jai
Baba.
Jai Baba.
Jai Baba, everybody.
Jai Mahir Baba. Jai Mahir
Baba.
Hello.